Welcome to Belmont Banter, the official podcast of Whitstable Town FC. Every week we chat to ex-players, supporters and invited guests here on Belmont Banter.
Welcome to the official podcast of Whitstable Town FC.
Whitstable Town Football Club's main sponsor is Fibertech UK Limited.
Hello again, everyone. Welcome to Belmont Banter. And today's guest is Will Graham. Now, Will's no stranger to Whitstable Town Football Club. Personally, I have not got a clue how his football career started and indeed when. Will, who was responsible for you getting you involved in football? I think it possibly must be your dad.
Yeah, so, it's my dad was a goalkeeper and had played local level. Also, I've got quite a famous uncle in terms of local men's football, Bill Clark, that's done a lot of stuff within the local game on Saturdays and Sunday football, and quite infamous in terms of getting good football teams together. So it's sort of run in the family, but my dad decided towards the end of his playing career that he wanted to set up a youth team, which was going to be sort of part of the Tyler Hill and the Bill Clark sort of club, and was going to become a youth section. So he started that back in 92. So I was only seven. And back then, in them Victorian days, so to speak, you didn't really have a lot of youth football. It was either, the bigger you was, if you were seven and there was only under 14, so you could only play, you're either big enough and ugly enough, or you just got on with it. So, it was a bit of a slow burner, but we used to play lots of friendlies and stuff like that. And then, so that's how the journey started, really.
Where did you progress from there? What other teams did you play for? Or was it school?
So I played within my school system. I think I was one of the only players to play up in the year six team in year four. I think maybe because of my height, and I was pretty good for my age. So I was quite identified quite early to play up a couple of years in primary school, which was nice, And then as I broke into secondary school, I still remained at Tyler Hill, playing within their youth teams under my dad. And I eventually was quite lucky enough to get put into the district team with quite a few former Whitstable Town players, Aaron Knight, Dan Lawrence, Ben Lawrence. Quite a selection of very good players. Dan Tanner, Tom Parker. So we had quite a good district team. And then through sort of good performing and stuff like that, I actually broke into the Kent team as well. So I was a Kent schools player from, I think, 12 to about 16. And again, played with some lads that played in the pro game, Leroy Leiter, George Boyd. So that's how it started, really. But I eventually found myself breaking into Whitstable Town under 15s, which was run by a club legend, Colin Budge. We had a good little team there. And then at 16s, I left Whitstable and went to play for Dover Athletic. And that's where I sort of broke into the 16s, 18s reserves, and then eventually made it into the first team. And then went from there, and I got signed by Jim and Danny Ward at Ramsgate. And then let's say that's how it sort of concluded, which, built my relationship up with the two Ward brothers.
Their names keep coming up all the time. Unbelievable. You know what? How many lives they touch is really amazing. Honestly, it is.
Yeah, I mean, like I say, it was at the time I was about 21, 22, on the fringes of the first team at Dover and playing mainly reserves. And I basically just met Jim on a Saturday afternoon over at Jackie Baker's when I was coaching. And he sort of come up to me and said, "I've watched you a couple of times. I'd love for you to come down and play for us." And I was quite shell-shocked, actually, because they had just won the Ryman South and got promoted to the Prem. And actually, the first team that I couldn't get into, so on a regular basis at Dover, actually didn't even, get promoted, and Ramsgate did. So it was quite a bit of a summer, really, to get asked to join Ramsgate and play in the Ryman Premier Division. And but I couldn't make the first team every week in the team that didn't get promoted at Dover. So, but yeah, Jim saw something in me, and It was something that really he gave me a lot of confidence to sort of jump into that really high level that I'd never really sampled and sort of just hit the ground running, really.
There's a lot of travelling, though, once you get into the Prem, isn't there?
Yeah, like I say, I was about 22 when I played, and I didn't really have any sort of expectations, really. I just thought I'd go in there and, you know, see how I got on. But, you know, I found myself starting the first league game, playing with the fantastic Ollie Schultz that went on to do really well at Dover and could have probably gone on to play Football League if he would have got his head down a little bit better. But, yeah, I found myself starting, and it was crazy because, you know, a season or two before I was playing Sunday League, and now I'm playing it in front of AFC Wimbledon on a Tuesday night in front of 4,500 supporters. It was, you know, and that's when the Ryman Prem was a really good standard. It was like Wimbledon, Chelmsford, Boreham Wood, Billericay. You know, we had some fantastic games. So for me, I was starstruck. I was walking into these big grounds with big, you know, big support, and playing against some ex-pros like Marcus Gale and people like that, the players that I'd been watching on the telly, and now I'm marking them. It was, you know, it was great. And I wouldn't have got there without Jim and Danny's support, to be fair.
That's lovely. And I guess because I've seen you playing about a bit, well, quite a bit, actually, that you played centre-half for them, did you?
I did, yeah. I was, I'd always played as a centre-forward as a kid, and then as I got to start getting to sort of senior level, yeah, I started dropping back into them centre-half roles. And technically on the ball, I wasn't the greatest, but, you know, in that sort of time and era, it was head and kick it, you know, be strong, be aggressive. And that's what I tried to pride myself on. But, you know, looking back now as a 35-year-old, if I could have had the time again and a little bit more of the knowledge that I hold now as a coach and the game, how it's developed, I think I would have put a lot more into my game, and I would have been a bit more resilient at times. And, you know, I think I could have probably done a little bit better and given a little bit more.
Yeah, I've had one or two guys on here said almost exactly the same thing. You know, if I could tell my 16-year-old self what I know now, as far as training was concerned, diet, you know, fitness, everything, it would be in a different story.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, even going back in, you know, into the kid, like the youth side of things, you know, some of these kids have got these academies now, they've got 3Gs to play on, you know, the AstroTurfs, and they've got access to sessions, you know, they've got a library of stuff that then they can grab hold of. You know, back in when I was coming through the youth game, it was very much being out in the fields, just making your own rules up and learning the game, just playing, you know, on your own, really. But it's, if there's one of the biggest regrets I've got, it's the opportunity I had at Ramsgate. If I would have put a bit more dedication and a bit more focus in, I think, you know, I could have really excelled, but I didn't. I was quite weak, you know, in the mindset. I didn't really commit to the football as much as I should have done. You know, and even as a coach, as you know, Tony, you hear me sometimes bellowing from the side of the pitch, you know, and my expectations of players as a coach is high, but, you know, as a player, being bell, you know, shouted at by Jim and Danny, I probably didn't take on as much as I should have done. So that's definitely a regret of mine.
I think as a coach, you know, especially that you've played, and as you say, a decent level, that must help you when you're directing younger players now, surely.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, like I say, I mean, at the moment I'm coaching sort of younger players, but, you know, I have coached the 14s, 15s, 16s and 18s and even 23s. And it is very much, you know, the modern day tone. You're sort of saying to these kids, you know, like expecting big wages a week and, you know, and thinking that just because you've done well at 18s, that makes you a first team player. It's very, very different to what you envisage. It's, you know, I come from an era of players where, you know, like the likes of Sean Welfords and Ollie Schultz and Lee Minchells and people like that, that they didn't just talk about how good they was, they showed it, you know, and if that they didn't hold any prisoners. And there wasn't an expectancy with them. You know, if they wanted a little bit of extra money a week from the club, that they proved that. You know, there wasn't no expectancy. And I find now when you're talking to sometimes 16, 17, 18-year-old lads, they sort of expect that they should be a first-team player because they've been told how good they are. You know, there's a little bit of an unwillingness to really go and show it. So, yeah, so my pathway from that football and being there, seeing it, done it, would be very, very transparent with the youth players of today and saying, look, you know, just because you do well at youth games, playing on a Tuesday night at the Belmont against, you know, your Hastings, it's a different ball game. You know, it's a lot quicker and it's a lot more harder. You know, you've got to be more resilient. You've got to be more observant of your surroundings. And you've got to get used to a couple of hundred people screaming and shouting at you and not, you know, you potentially not liking that. So, yeah, I definitely pass that knowledge on as best I can to the youth players that I coach.
Although there's only, say, 200, 300, maybe 400 people at the ground, it's very intimidating when they're literally leaning on a barrier and they're less than 2 yards from you and you're the winger getting grief all the time. And that can destroy a young player, can't it?
Exactly. You know, when they've been playing on a Sunday morning at, you know, a youth football pitch and there's, you know, parents, mums and dads on the field and, you know, it's all very nice and very, very, you know, welcoming and things like that. And then they've got this expectations that they're going to come into a ground that's going to be the same, you know. And again, even at our level, like the Oyster Boys are, you know, they sing their hearts out and, you know, they protect their club and they protect their players. So, yeah, if you're playing against Whitstable, you might be told stuff that you don't like to be hit, you know, to be spoken about. And again, it can make or break you, really. And like you say, it's only 200, 300, 400 supporters. However, in them sort of environments, you can hear every single comment. Whereas if it's 3,000, 4,000 people, you might hear the rumbles of people, but you're not going to hear the specific, you know, chant, so to speak. So, yeah, it's something that is difficult. I found it difficult and I had to learn very quickly or I'd find myself probably not being there.
How long did you actually stay at Ramsgate for then?
So I was at Ramsgate from about 21 to about 24. And then I'd done my ACL playing against Wharton and Hersham for Jim and Danny. And yeah, I just couldn't get it fit. I mean, again, like we say, Tony, about how the game's evolved and the world's evolved. An ACL 11 years ago was an injury that people didn't really understand that is a really bad injury. And I mean, I'd done about 90% damage to my knee completely. So it was completely ruined and it took 2 surgeries to try and repair it. And, you know, then trying to come back without the internet to find out what to do, how to do it. You know, and unfortunately, the NHS at the time, I got rehab for an hour every 2 weeks. So I found it very difficult to come back and recover and get back to playing. I did give it a go, but I just, you know, found that I was worrying about doing it again because it was such a long-term injury.
Yeah, it's such a traumatic thing, isn't it? That's hit home again with the Olympics. I listened to one of the cyclists talking about, you know, when they've had a spill. She was saying that, you know, she gets back up on her bike, but she's just been knocked off her bike at 50 miles an hour and it stays in your head. She said, I couldn't commit the way I'd like to commit because it's there. It's like a parrot on your shoulder, isn't it?
Exactly that. And that's very much hits home with me as well. It wasn't a case that my knee, the surgeon wasn't correct or the surgery didn't work. You know, it did work. The rehab probably wasn't where it needed to be, probably from my own point of view, and wasn't as frequent as I needed it to be to repair it. But when I did try to come back the following year for pre-season, I always had that little voice in my head thinking, you can't afford to do it again. You know, and poor Michael Yarny, who's obviously a club favourite, he done his ACL just before I done mine, went private, come back and done it again the following year. So he had 2 ACLs in 2 years. And yeah, I wasn't strong enough, I suppose, in the head and with my work situation and things like that. I couldn't afford to spend another year limped up on crutches and, you know, yeah, being a bit of a burden, really.
It's a difficult one, isn't it? Because, yeah, again, work comes into it. You know, you go and play this game for pleasure. You're not getting really paid for it, proper wages. And you've got to earn a living. So there's a very fine balance, isn't there?
Yeah, of course. I mean, we love the game. And again, it's another thing that as I've got older, I've tried to appreciate in terms of my coaching and my delivery. And, you know, the players at this level, they're getting paid well. You know, some clubs are getting paid very, very well. And I suppose that what comes along with that is the expectancy for them to be, you know, football, 24/7. And you know, no matter how much money you're on, people have families, people have jobs. And, you know, unfortunately, we're not in all in a privileged position where this can be our full-time position. And so, yeah, so especially from a playing point of view, I've definitely taken on board that, yes, it's nice to have players there every single night on time, doing what they're doing, doing extras, being in the gym every single night they're not training. But then, yeah, you've also got to remember that they've got to work, they've got families. So you've got to have the balance right.
When did you actually take the decision that that was it, you're going to walk away then?
I think it was probably when I tried to come back the following year in pre-season under Jim and Dan, and I felt off. I felt like I wasn't sharp. I felt like I was worrying about going for tackles. I sort of had a chat with Jim and I said, look, I don't feel like it's ready. I don't feel like it's right. And to be fair to Jim, he wanted me to stick around. He wanted me to be around the changing room and he wanted me to persevere with it. But I felt like I needed to sort of take myself out of the situation in a matter of ways to sort of bring myself out, to sort of evaluate where I was, what did I need to do? If I was going to come back, what else did I need to do? And also I needed to be fair to the players and also Jim and Danny, and sort of, you know, not being in and around it, knowing that I probably wasn't right going forward. So it was probably about the build up in that pre-season. I sort of decided, look, come away, focus on my coaching, and then to see how my knee sort of goes from there. And yeah, I tried playing on Sundays and, you know, just to keep myself active. And it just, yeah, I just never, ever really got over the ACL injury, both mentally and physically.
Whitstable Town Football Club's main sponsor is Fibertech UK Limited.
When then did you make the decision about the coaching? Because that's where you are at the moment, isn't it?
Yeah, so I basically started coaching within Tyler Hill Youth when I was 14. So I started quite young. And then, like I say, alongside playing, I was doing my badges and I was coaching for local companies such as Soccer Elite. And I was working for Arsenal Football Club and doing little bits for them within schools. So, yeah, I was always involved in coaching, even alongside playing. But when it came to the decision to stop playing, I sort of really sort of pushed my coaching to the top of the table, really. And I quickly done my UEFA B, and then so I've also done other-minded coaching badges like goalkeeping badge and stuff like that. So, yeah, then I just went into the youth game and just started coaching through the youth system and coaching different age groups and different abilities, really. And that's how it really started.
What turn of events brought you back to Whitstable then?
So, yeah, quite funny. It was I was coaching at Margate under 18s, and I probably had the second or third best team in the county at the time. I had players like Liam King. I had who else did I have? Aaron Simpson. So yeah, I had a very good, very strong team. And Jim and Danny had sort of heard about the team and heard that, you know, that I was in there coaching, and I think they'd heard about my coaching ability, and they were out of work at the time, and I think they went for the Whitstable job. And I just received a message from Danny saying, hello, mate, not long time no speak. Would it be good to have a chat? I was like, yeah, well, this is a bit strange. I haven't spoke to Danny in a while, yeah. And then he sort of said, look, we've heard about your coaching. We'd love you to come in and be our first team coach. And for me, to be a first team coach at, I think, probably about 26, I was like, yeah, 100%. I'm really eager to get into that sort of standard and work at first team level. So it sort of went from there, really. And then we put the infamous team together that done so well that year.
It was fantastic, wasn't it? You were an integral part of that as well. So, you know, your CV, that must stack up quite nicely.
Yeah, I mean, for me, I've got to, in terms of working at, you know, first team level, I've got to say it's probably the most enjoyable season I've ever had. You know, and again, that starts from yourself down to the support, the Oyster Boys and the supporters, down to the 23s and the first team players we had, and Jim and Danny that, you know, knitted it all together. It was just such an enjoyable year that I look back with great memories, and some of the memories and just such of the togetherness of the team, you know. And I think when we put that team together in the June the previous year, we sort of really didn't know where we were going to be, because Whitstable, you know, I think I don't think it's too harsh to say Whitsport had never really pushed the top half of that level. You know, they'd always done okay. And then we put this team together and we didn't really know where it would sit. You know, we had the likes of Ian Pullman, who's goal machine at that level. Kane Rowland, who was a kid. You know, he was only playing under-18s the year before. You know, we had Hurdy, who was Scott Hurdy, who was absolutely unreal, but never really had a team around him where he could say that he could really show how good he could have been. So, yeah, we put this team together and we, looking back at it, we probably had 12 recognised first team players, and then the rest were made up of under-23s that were doing well, that were, you know, in and around the first team. And, you know, I look back now with such good memories. We had a good social life. You know, we went out drinking together. We spent time together. You know, our WhatsApp groups and things like that. We were always doing something to keep us ticking over, and it was brilliant. It was a really, really good season.
Yeah, you know, to be part of something like that must have been fabulous for you. I've got to say about Jim and Danny, and I've said this before, but they're both underrated as managers, joint management team that they've got, because how can I compare him to anybody? Well, let's go for Scott Fawlter. But yeah, you go down there and for whatever reason, you feel your hackles on the back of your neck would rise. Jimmy and Danny had the same effect. But of course, when they're yours, you feel completely different about them.
Yeah.
And you can, but you can also understand why people get upset, because, you know, a couple of Scottish lads on the touchline, their voice can be heard from a million miles away. If one's not shouting, the other is.
Yeah.
But what a team they are together, aren't they?
Well, this is the thing. I mean, they've worked together for so many years and have been so successful. And again, it depends what you deem success as well. You know, success, some people think, is titles and trophies, and some people is success is taking a team that haven't pushed to the heights that we did and doing that, you know. And they didn't do that with an incredibly big budget in comparison to our level. So it was very important about the environment they set and the togetherness, and everyone was pulling in the right direction, and everyone was making sure that if we weren't going to win a game of football, we weren't as good as the opposition that we were playing against. We were going to make them, you know, it was going to be a dogfight. And like you say, the environment that Scott Fawlter set, you always know what you're going to get out of a Scott Fawlter team. And again, that's not derogatory. That's not a bad thing. That's, you deal with the tools that you get and you try and get the best out of them. And, you know, I look back at some of them games when we were together with Jim and Danny, and Walton Casuals was a massive one at home when we were 3-0 down after 20 minutes, down and out completely. You know, the halftime team talk from Jim and Danny was, you know, the cups were going, the walls were a bit, you know, being painted red. It was not a very nice changing room at halftime. And then for us to put that back together, Jim and Danny included, putting that all back together, and then for us to win it 4-3 with the last kick of the game, just a magic moment. And one that often it comes up on my memories on my social media, and I always share it with the boys, with Rhys Crimmon and Butch and, you know, people like that. And it's just one of them moments that we all talk about that's just, that was amazing.
Yeah, it's great, isn't it? Really lovely feeling. And unfortunately, and I know that they were both mad, mad keen to take us another step further, which they felt they got the team to do it. External reasons, and you and I know what those external reasons were, we were unable to see it forward, and it's such a shame, wasn't it?
Yeah, and it's very difficult for people, I suppose, outside looking in,
yes,
to debate on the scenes that sort of went on. Again, it's, we had made such progression, and we had such a, you know, not to pull him out, but Scott Hurd had interest from everywhere. And we wanted to continue going forward with what we had built and add to it to have a real go the following season. And, you know, not just be finishing eighth. We wanted to be in the playoffs or go for the league. And I think with a little bit more of an investment, with just a couple of players here or there, I think we could have really, really pushed the team and the club into places where they never dreamed of being. But again, it's one of them. Comments on it, you only have the amount of money that you have, and, you know, you live within your means, and that's the way it is. And again, ambition is ambition. And I think Jim and Danny at that time sort of saw ambition coming from a, you know, coming back from a Ramsgate, which is a club they've loved and adored over the years, and saw the ambition being sort of met in other avenues. And I think that was, it was massively unfortunate, because I think two or three more players, we could have gone again with that second season. We would all stuck together and we would have given it a real go.
Listening to you now, Will, this is, I feel a tinge of sadness now that you're not involved at senior level now, because you've got such a desire for it, haven't you?
Yeah, and it's hard, because it's one of them things, and it's very, very true. You know, when you are out of it, you do almost get forgotten. You know, there's so many great people that have been involved in managing, coaching at that level and higher and lower that done really, really well and nowhere to be heard of or seen at now. And it is very, very difficult. I always put myself in terms of my coaching ability up at the very top in terms of how our level. I'm definitely a student of the game. I'm someone that I don't sit still and just think, well, them sessions worked 10 years ago, so I'll keep them. I'm someone that always likes to evolve my, you know, my library. And yeah, it's somewhere I'd always love to get myself back in and around it. But again, you've got to be in the right place at the right time and just hope something lands. But again, there's people out there that, if they are interested, they know where I am and they know what I can bring to the table. And I'm sure at some point I will be back on the touchline at first team level doing something.
That was a great comment. Really good. And now bring us up to date then with what you're actually doing now.
So, yeah. So what I basically last season, I decided that I was being asked by lots of managers, you know, as I wasn't, you know, involved with a club at the time, I was being asked by lots of managers, would I go and watch a game? Would I do a report for them? And, you know, obviously people, I suppose, respect my opinion on opposition and players. I sort of had a conversation with a friend and he said, why don't you set this up as a business while you're out of coaching? And I said, well, I don't really need to. I can just, you know, keep it low key. And he sort of battered me down and said, you should do it as a business. Like, this could be really good. And so I went, right, okay. So I set up a company called Elite Premier Scouting. Again, very, very minor, very small. Just basically offering my services to clubs for an affordable price. Just going out, watching games, doing opposition reports for clubs. And quite quickly, within probably about six to 12 weeks of doing it, I had Dover Athletic, I had Stockport County of all teams, I had Cray Wanderers, I had Herne Bay, I had all these teams that were asking me to go and Hastings to do reports. And I was sort of took that. I couldn't fit them all in at the time because I was doing it on my own. And it was brilliant, to be fair. I was getting paid, you know, quite nice money and going, sitting in a stand, watching football and telling people my opinion on it. It was brilliant. And it kept me involved, Tony. You know, I wasn't sat at home watching Soccer Saturday. I was out where I love to be in non-league football, watching football and talking to football about people, you know, with people. So, yeah, so then obviously lockdown closed that back down for a while. And again, it's this picking up again at the moment. And I was at Wingate in Finchley this Saturday doing a report for Margate for Jay Saunders. And again, I'm at Bedfont Sports next Saturday for Herne Bay, who got them in the FA Cup. So, yeah, I'm out and about. You always find me somewhere, Tony, watching a game and writing things down.
Have you had to take on any staff?
So, yeah, so I've been out there looking to add a couple of people because the Cray Wanderers job has gone because obviously the management team that I was working for left, but now I'm now working for Lewis where they've gone. So now the journeys are a lot bigger. So I'm definitely looking to get a couple of people involved and, you know, earn a little bit of beer money on a weekend and to come watch a game of football. But yeah, it's at the moment I'm quite a solo entity, but definitely looking to add more people in so then we can branch out and get a little bit wider.
I think it's got to be the right people though, hasn't it? I mean, it can't just be some guy who you normally see at a ground every week. It's got to be someone who knows a bit about the game. Interestingly enough, your old man knows quite a bit about the game because I've stood alongside him a couple of times at a game and he makes some quite poignant comments. He really does.
Yeah, it's one of them things, you know, I'm a bit of a control freak when it comes to the game, and it's whether it's coaching, managing, playing, scouting, it's one of them that I like to know that it's got my stamp on it, and it, you know, it's being, it's got my mark. So a lot of the stuff, as long as I can fit it in, I will always try and do it myself, and not because that's because I want to, you know, greed it all in. It's just simply because I like to make sure that the reports are always done to a certain standard, as I would do my coaching and stuff that way. But yeah, there's always a added room to ask the old man to go and watch a game for me every now and then and do me a report.
He'll certainly say it like it is. He wouldn't sugarcoat anything, will he?
Yeah. So he has to be a bit more observant rather than judgmental. So I'll tell him that and say to him, you can't just be too judgmental.
Nice one. Well, it's been a fascinating chat today. I've really enjoyed it. The best thing about what I do, you know, and I'm only doing it for the club, and in fact, anybody that wants to tell me their story, I'm happy to have them on. I have people on that's never ever played for Whitstable. They've visited the ground with their other clubs or passing through, but it's anybody basically that's played football in and around the southeast. And I've had some fantastic journeys myself, because I feel as if I've found out more, like I've done with you today. Mm-hmm. You know, we've never had the opportunity to sit down and talk like this before.
No.
And it's been good. And to see your passion coming through when you talk about Jim and Danny and the clubs and what you're doing now is fantastic.
Yeah, it's something, like I say, when it comes to football, I'll sit down and talk to anyone about football. I can talk about the very highest to the very lowest to the youth. You know, I'm someone that, like I say, I'd like to be classed myself as a student of the game, and I like to talk about football, and that's something that will never leave me. And it's something now that I'm back involved with, helping the old man's Tyler Hill youth team develop. We just signed a partnership with Whitstable Town, because Whitstable Town's a club that's very close to my heart. So yeah, we're linking in with the club, with Whitstable, and you know, so you'll be seeing me around Whitstable. So we have plenty more opportunities for chats, mate.
That's lovely. All right, so we'll call it a day for now, Will. But from me here at Belmont Banter and Will Graham on the other end of a Zoom call, Will, it's been a pleasure, mate, and I'll see you down the Belmont soon.
Always, you take care. Speak to you soon, mate.
Cheers. Take care. Cheers. Thank you.
Whitstable Town Football Club's main sponsor is Fibertech UK Limited. They are providers of optical fibre services to the telecoms industry, specialising in optical fibre provision, local and long haul. We offer a full turnkey solution to our clients throughout London and the south of England. Contact us through the website for more details.
Your host, Tony Rouse, every week on Belmont Banter, for news about local football in Kent and beyond.
I do hope that you've enjoyed today's episode of Belmont Banter. Don't forget, there's a new episode out every week, which comes out on a Sunday night, early Monday morning. And you can leave your suggestions for a guest to invite at the end. And leave a like, and don't forget to pass it on to all your mates. Cheers!